How many of you have ever seen a television advertisement, a billboard, heard a radio ad that makes you think that if you could only have this product, that your life would be great? Right? If you only bought Diet Pepsi and drank it, you're going to be the most excellent person there ever was. Right? Or if you have the new iPhone 6, you're going to be the most intelligent, smartest person on the planet. Right? Can you think of some others? We see them every day. Thousands upon thousands of images flash before our eyes telling us that if we could only do this or have this product or wear these clothes or drive this car or use this perfume or this lotion, that everything in life is going to be great and everything is going to be wonderful, right? We've seen it. We live it day in and day out because we're taught in society to think about whom before others. Who? Yes, me. Me. I call this, and this is not the sermon for this morning, but this is the sermon will happen at some point, the unholy trinity of me, myself, and I. Right? Society teaches us to think about me, myself, and I before anyone else. It's not about anybody else. It's about what do I have and what can I get and how can I make myself better. Right? That's what it's all about. Right? Not really. If you listen to all of our lessons this morning, that's not what it's about at all. We get the covenant with Abraham, right? Or Abram, actually, at that point. And God changed Abram's name to Abraham and said that he would be the father of many nations, and that even Sarah, in her old age, Sarah was about 90 years old, 90 to 95, maybe even a little older, when she had Isaac. Women? Thank you. That's all I have to say. Thank you. Right. It's the promise that's held to. And I love the line in Romans. Did you hear it? That Abram hoped against hope. He hoped against hope. Because when a bunch of people do something that's wrong, does that make it right? Wrong is wrong no matter if everybody is doing it. Right is right even if nobody's doing it. You see, these lessons this morning is about the proper perspective and what we see and how we see it. This morning in our gospel lesson, we have Jesus teaching the disciples, and it said, and he began to teach them that he was going to have to go, and he was going to go in Jerusalem. They were going to arrest him. They were going to put him on trial. They were going to scourge him. They were going to beat him. And then finally, he was going to die. Right? He said three things to them that was going to happen. He said, I want to make sure I get this right. So. He said that he was going to go undergo suffering, be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, and then be killed. He was going to undergo great suffering. He was going to be rejected by the leadership of the Jewish church and the leadership in Jerusalem, and then he was going to be killed. And then he said, and then 3 days later will rise again. The disciples heard all of that because it says right after that he spoke to them very plainly. Right? He said this to them in a way that they could understand. It was very plain English. He said he's going to suffer. He's going to be rejected, and he's going to be killed. And then he's going to rise again. Now, we heard all four of those, right? The disciples, it seems, only heard the first three. Or they completely skipped over that last one. But think about that for a moment. If you had just walked with this man for 3 years and seen everything that he's seen and been everywhere with him and helped to do the things that he had done, and he says to you that he's going to go into this next town and he's going to get scourged and then he's going to be rejected, right? He's going to go undergo suffering. He's going to be rejected and then they're going to kill him. Would you listen beyond that to hear that he was going to rise again in 3 days or even believe that at this point? Because Lazarus was not raised from the dead in the Gospel of Mark. Right? Lazarus was raised from the dead in the Gospel of John. So the Gospel of Mark knows nothing about anyone rising from the dead. Jesus said to them very plainly. And then it says, just very nonchalantly, I think, that Peter listened to this and rebuked Jesus, right? Took him aside and rebuked him. How do you picture that event happening? I need a volunteer. right, so you're Jesus. You know, like that? And I'm thinking, so you said that you're going to, you know,
okay.
He said, I'm going to be scourged, rejected by the chief priests and the elders, and be killed, and after 3 days, rise again.
So then Peter comes over and goes, Jesus.
Is that the way you picture that happening? Is that Peter just not walking off up and calling Jesus over? Actually, it's more like this. Jesus, this can't happen! This isn't the way that it's going to be! He grabs hold of him and physically moves him over. He grabs hold of him and pulls him over and just like shakes him. This isn't the way that it's going to happen! He's physically in the way of Jesus. Right? He's standing between Jesus and where Jesus needs to go. And Jesus said to him, one of the best lines, get behind me, Satan. Or, opissimus on high. There's your Greek for life. Opissimus. Isn't it great? It means get behind me, right? Opissimus. Mu is me. Opisso is behind. Okay? Jesus uses these two words someplace else in the Gospel of Mark. In the Gospel of Matthew. I think Kurt remembers. I've actually preached this before, since I remember it. Jesus said to the disciples as he's walking along the Sea of Galilee, he says to Simon and Peter, he says, follow me. He says, open the moon. Get behind me. We picture that Jesus walking down the Sea of Galilee or something, and he sees these two guys and he says, hey, come on and go walk with me, right? It's the thing where we're going to walk together. We're going to go on a journey. Jesus says, orient yourself to the way that you need to orient yourself. Right? He says then after Peter rebukes him, he says, if anyone wants to be my follower, he has to deny himself and take up their cross. What is a cross? What is that thing that you need to take up? What is that thing that you need to carry? I don't think it's something that we necessarily have to carry. It's something that we need to focus on. This morning, in the Romans passage, Paul says that it was reckoned to him as righteousness. We see that one other place when it talks about Abraham. In the Hall of Fame of Faith, in Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, it talks about all of those who have followed in faith and done the things that God called for them to do. And in chapter 12, we get a wonderful verse. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. Fix your eyes upon Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. I used to have a shirt that said cross-eyed, and it had Hebrews 12, 2 written on it. Because our eyes are fixed upon Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. It's about the proper perspective. If you can't see the cross, you're not looking in the right place. If you're looking Jesus in the eye, you're in the wrong place. We need to see the back of Jesus' head. Because he's leading us where we need to go. And if we're looking at him and telling him that this isn't the way it's supposed to be, then we're fixing our eyes upon what we think God's mission is and not what God's mission really is. It's about us seeing things the way they are and knowing that our thoughts and our ways are not God's thoughts and not God's ways. And that God's thoughts and God's ways are much better than our thoughts and our ways. It's about understanding and seeing where we're being led to go. It's about understanding and seeing who we're supposed to follow. See, Peter thought that he knew what was going to happen because he couldn't wrap his mind around the chaos. And that's okay. Because who's leading us into that chaos? Jesus. So fix your eyes upon Jesus. And know that no matter where he leads you, that he's never going to leave you there alone. That he's always going to be with you. And he's always going to walk with you. And give you the strength and the courage to go through whatever it is that he leads us all into. But know that our thoughts are not his thoughts. And that we have to give up our own selves so that we can take off the life that he's given to us. Because I guarantee you, when you let go of worrying about number one, and worry about number one, that your life's going to be so much better. And things are going to be so much different. And the blessings are simply going to flow. Because that's the miracle of everything in the gospel. That when you give everything up,
He definitely gives you more back and blesses and fills your life with an overabundance of things that you can never possibly imagine. But that's not the reason to do it. The reason to do it is because He so loved you that He went to that cross, and now He wants you to go home.